Historians called the transfer of plants and animals that began with the 15th and early 16th century European-American contact the Columbian Exchange. The directions of these biological transfers and their effects on the environments and on the people of Europe and the Americas shaped the modern world that we live in, and to a great extent are still going on. American maize and potatoes and cassava fed growing European and African and Asian populations, allowing for the building of new cities and new industries. European animals like pigs and sheep and chicken and cattle thrived in the Americas, enabling both natives and Europeans to expand their populations and to change their cultures. But before, most of the people that Columbus had incorrectly called Indians, and the name stuck, before they had a chance to benefit from the new food sources introduced by the Europeans, the natives were struck down by a largely accidental transfer of viruses and bacteria from Europeans to Americans, which caused the deaths of 90%, possibly 95% of the Native American population. When prehistoric Europeans and Asians began living in close contact with the species that they domesticated, the people changed along with the animals that they kept. Most of humanity's major diseases originate in animals and cross from domesticated species to their human keepers. This is as true of the present as it was of the past. Whooping cough and influenza came from pigs, measles and smallpox came from cattle, malaria and avian flu come from chickens. The people who domesticated these species and lived with the animals for generations co-evolved with them and developed some resistance to these pathogens. Animal diseases became survivable when people developed antibodies and immunities. But without this inherited protection that was enjoyed by most Asians and Europeans and Africans, even a routine childhood disease, such as chickenpox or the flu, can be devastating. The introduction of a disease into an area without inherited immunity is called a virgin soil epidemic. Such epidemics had happened in Europe and Asia, such as when the Romans spread smallpox into the populations that they conquered. And of course, had happened more recently in Europe when the expanding Mongols had introduced bubonic plague into China and then into the Mediterranean. The Black Death killed probably half, maybe two-thirds of the population of Europe in the 14th century, reducing world population by about 100 million people. Virgin soil epidemics spread across the Americas when explorers and colonists and missionaries introduced European diseases to natives who had been isolated for thousands of years. The Americans had no immunities at all. And as I said, even diseases that were no longer much of a threat to Europeans killed millions of natives. The Eurasian diseases that attacked native populations included smallpox, measles, chickenpox, influenza, typhus, cholera, typhoid, diphtheria, bubonic plague, scarlet fever, whooping cough, and malaria. And they came one after another. The impact of these Eurasian diseases on Americans was one of human history's most abrupt and severe population disasters. Even the Black Death didn't kill as large a percentage of Europeans. And when endemic European diseases recurred, they generally killed their victims over a much longer time span due to the inherited immunity of some parts of the European population. American native populations had no such safeguards, and the diseases spread virulently. For example, there were probably over a million people living on the Caribbean island of Hispaniola alone in 1492, when Columbus left his 39 sailors there at La Navidad. By 1548, there were only 500 natives left alive. 999,500 people or more had disappeared. The populations of the other Caribbean islands were similarly wiped out. Cuba had 1.5 million people, and it went to zero as well. The whole Arawak or Taíno civilization disappeared. And this is not only a tragedy of cultural loss. The reduction of native populations also began a cycle of violence that became central to American history. Once there were no natives left, to work on European sugar plantations, African slaves became crucial to the survival of the West Indies and the Portuguese-Brazilian economies. The greater population densities of Central and South America enabled contagious diseases to spread quickly there. Heavily traveled roads and trade routes in central Mexico actually helped disease to spread beyond the areas that had been reached by Spanish conquistadors. Cities were wiped out that had never seen a white man. The population of the Aztec heartland in the Valley of Mexico dropped from probably about 25 million on the eve of Spanish conquest to just under 17 million a decade later. One out of every three native people died in just 10 years. After another decade, the Aztec population was reduced to about 6 million. So now, after 20 years, three out of four people in the Aztec world had disappeared. Imagine writing a list of your 10 closest friends and family, and then just randomly crossing out seven names. By 1580, the Aztec Empire had been hollowed out to less than 2 million people, from a starting point of 25 million. So cross off two more people from your list. You're down to one friend. The depopulation of the Americas is one of the Earth's most significant population disasters, both in its human toll and in the changes that it brought about. Over the years, as you might expect, there has been a lot of controversy about just what happened. Critics of Spanish colonialism, many of them Spanish, like the priest Bartolomé de las Casas, who at the time didn't know about the way disease was transmitted, accused the Spaniards of atrocities in what became known as the Black Legend. To defend themselves, the colonialists accused the Aztec and the Inca empires with atrocities of their own, suggesting that they needed to be overthrown. And many emphasized the support that the conquistadors probably received from the indigenous rivals of these empires, who were happy to see them overthrown. Textbooks often reflect some of these biases. One that I've used for this class a couple years ago, for example, mentioned that allegedly between 20,000 and 80,000 men, women, and children were slaughtered in a single Aztec religious ceremony in 1487. This may or may not be true, but even if it is, compare that to the deaths of 20 million men, women, and children that followed the Spanish invasion of Central and South America. So, before we move on, a couple more questions. First, why were native populations so susceptible to European diseases? And then secondly, how did disease affect the native society's ability to resist European invaders?